Good morning, everybody. So this week, as I was preparing for this, this scripture verse kept coming through my mind, and I'm going to share it with you. It's from 1 Kings, chapter 19, verse 11. So it's about Elijah, and God sends him to the mountain to meet with him. And as he's on that mountain, he sends the wind and the rain, and Elijah's thinking that God's voice is going to be in that wind and rain. Well, it's not. Then he sends an earthquake, and he thinks, well, it's going to be in there, and it's not. Then he sends fire, and he says, certainly it's going to be in the fire, and it's not. So then what happens? The still, small voice of God, and that is where he spoke with him. So would you pray with me before we start? Father God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to come into this building and worship you, because it's all about worshiping you. Please calm our minds and get rid of the wind and the earthquakes and the fire that just consumes us all the time. And just be with us today in that still small voice and speak to us so we can thoroughly worship you. It's not about us receiving from you today. It is about us giving to you all we are. So please be with us. Holy Spirit, help us out with this. And let's make this an hour that is dedicated completely and totally to you. In your name we pray. Amen. So join us in Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, because he is every blessing.
Accepted, you were. That was beautiful.
Join me in prayer, and I'm going to start this prayer, but I'm going to ask for you and invite you to come and share the Lord's Prayer with me at the end of it. Take this time just to prepare your hearts, just to receive the word. Morning, Father. We just thank you so much for this time to come and to worship you, to praise and exalt the living Lord, the Savior of the world, and to walk and enjoy the faith that you have put within us and is ignited by the work of the Spirit. You are good beyond measure. Your love is just unfathomable. It's unending. there's just no time where we face a moment without you. We just thank you for your presence, Lord. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence here today. And as we go to your word, we want to learn from your heart. We want to know how you feel about things. And the instructions from the word need to find an application in our hearts today. So we offer ourselves to you. Holy Spirit, do what you need to do in our hearts today. Accomplish what only you can. We thank you that your word never returns void. What it is sent to do, it accomplishes, and we need to get into agreement. So we come in union with your spirit, with one another, that we're going to grow. We're going to grow in our faith and exercise it today. We thank you that we can come as individuals, then we're precious to you, and we thank you that we come as a corporate body, and we want to be filled with thanksgiving as your holy people. So hear our prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So faith involves complete and humble obedience to God's will. Faith is revealed in action because we believe the Word of God is truth. Do you believe that the Word of God is truth for your life? Do you believe that this Word translates and can be applied to your life to bring you into a closer fellowship and relationship with Almighty God? If so, say amen.
Amen.
There you go. The Word of God has much to say about forgiveness. Turn to your neighbor and say, uh-oh. Yeah. Faith and forgiveness will always go together. The world paints an emotional dimension of forgiveness. Is forgiveness actually a feeling? The scripture says that forgiveness is a holy act, a priceless gift that cannot be experienced apart from faith. As followers of Christ, we'll be called upon again and again to use our faith in order to forgive others who have wronged us. It only makes sense, doesn't it? Because you and I have to use our faith to believe that God is truth, and he says he sent his son as the savior of the world, and we have to believe that he gave his life for us in order to receive that forgiveness. You and I are going to naturally need to turn around and forgive others as well. It is just the way that the Word of God has put forth for us and how we should live. Last week, the word came to teach us about a spiritual fight that we must actually expect. It's going to happen. We've been handed a fight, and we must choose who will be our master. We cannot serve two masters. We fight sinful inclinations in us in order to reveal the righteousness of Christ through us. It's essential to hold on to our faith and to fight with the weapons of our faith, the promises of God. The promises of God are our weapons. Living an eternal life in God's kingdom must remain our goal every single day. Every day, you and I need to start our day going like, okay, Holy Spirit, this is my day. I need to live in your eternal life, and I need to live close to your heart and live according to the work of your Spirit in me, and wherever you take me, Lord, don't let me deviate. Help me keep me on that goal, that path, if you will, toward your heart and your kingdom, because every day the enemy is going to come and try to fight you to get you off that path. So you need the work of the Spirit, and you need your commitment to be there, because if you expect something to happen and you prepare yourself in advance, you're better equipped to handle it when it actually does. Do you understand what I'm saying? If so, say amen. Amen. It's It's about preparing yourself, getting yourself. Not that you're hoping for bad things, but let's just face it. Your faith is always going to be under attack. Scripture tells us that over and over again. Your faith, if you truly believe that God is truth and he is guiding your life and he lives in you and he moves through you and you have your whole being involved in that whole love of God, that's who you are, then just know that the enemy is not excited about that, because if you stay in that place, you're serving your master, the holy God. Amen? The most high God. But if you get off, then you're actually serving the world and the master of the world. So we have to stay focused, and we have to stay on that path every day. Evil's always going to try to rise up and take on our faith. God's word and promises have to take dominion over it in order to harvest Christ's righteousness and reveal his glory to the world. Faith is exercised as we step out in obedience to the word of God. The word asks us to come out of the world and be separated. So we need to come out of the world's ways of viewing forgiveness. How do you view forgiveness? In our passage this morning, the disciples want to feel secure in their faith before doing the spiritual work they're commanded to do. They cry out and they ask Christ for more faith. Jesus does not answer their request for more faith. Instead, he tells them what they already have and how they must view themselves in order to exercise it. The word of the Lord. From Luke 17, and the passages 1 through 10, you need to be thinking about. One of the things Luke teaches, that we're not to sin against others and to cause them to sin. He teaches us what we do when somebody does sin against us, and he teaches that following Christ is going to involve forgiveness, but we serve him, and that's why we forgive. Luke 17, 1 through 10. Jesus says to his disciples, "There will always be something that causes people to sin, but anyone who causes them to sin is in for trouble. A person who causes even one of my little followers to sin would be better off thrown into the ocean with a heavy stone tied around their neck. So be careful what you do. Correct any followers of mine who sin, and forgive the ones who say they are sorry. Even if one of them mistreats you 7 times in one day and says, 'I'm sorry,' you should still forgive that person." The apostle said to the Lord, "This is a hard teaching. Make our faith stronger, Lord." Jesus replied, "If you had faith no bigger than a tiny mustard seed, you could tell this mulberry tree to pull itself up, roots and all, and to plant itself in the ocean, and it would obey. If your servant comes in from plowing or from taking care of the sheep, would you say, 'Welcome, come on in, have something to eat'? No, you wouldn't say that. You would say, 'Fix me something to eat, get ready to serve me so I can have my meal, and then later on you can eat and drink.' Servants don't deserve special thanks for doing what they're supposed to do, and that's how it should be with you. When you've done all you should, then say, 'We are merely servants, and we have simply done our duty.'" The request of the disciples isn't necessarily wrong, but it's misdirected. They do not need more faith. They need more trust. They need more trust to be faithful. We can only grow in our relationship with God as we trust our lives to him. An increase of faith will come to Christ's disciples as they walk in obedience to the will of the Master. Faith is revealed in virtue and spiritual understanding and strengthened as we learn the ways of God. And we're called to be partakers of the divine nature of God, so we must leave the world behind in order to step into what God has for us. So he teaches that forgiveness is a choice, but it's also an action. I hope you realize that you and I and all believers are the harvest of the radical forgiveness of Almighty God in Christ Jesus. the seed was planted in our hearts. We have allowed that word to germinate and grow and to help us understand the unfathomable grace that covers us and calls us to come to God. In the first century Greek, when this word forgiveness is used in Scripture, it's really about four different things. It's used in those connections. Remittance of a debt, to leave alone something or someone, to allow an action, to leave or send away, abandon, or to divorce from a situation. When we forgive others, we actually reveal appreciation to God for his forgiveness of our sin. Repentance is necessary to experience forgiveness. We know that we have to come to the Lord. If you have come to Jesus and you have asked him to be your Savior, you have come to say, Lord, I have sinned against your love commands, and I need you to forgive me. I repent of that sin. I confess it to you. I come to you and I ask for you to forgive me of that sin. And God is faithful to do that. Repentance, we've been studying in from the prophet Jeremiah on Wednesdays and Thursdays in our Bible study, our life lessons. And if you don't come to one of those lessons, you should. It's a very, very rich time in the Spirit of God. He is teaching us all the time. And certainly the prophets talked about repentance all the time. You say, what is repentance? It's a turning from the world's way to God's. And the prophets are sent to call God's people all the time. Come out of the world, come out of the world, come out of the world. Receive the forgiveness of God. Repent of your sins to do that. Well, when Jesus came and laid down his life, you and I needed to come before him and say, Lord, you know, forgive me. Forgive me. Now, repentance is connected with turning away from those things that we once did, that we have decided, according to the Word of God and been convicted by the Spirit, that are not a part of our life. They're not to be a part of our life. We have to walk away from those things. And God says, come on, come on, come on, and leave that behind. Follow me. And we're going to keep going here. So repentance is an action. Forgiveness of sins, for Almighty God forgiving our sins, is like the most amazing process, and we can't even fathom it. You know, you and I have trouble forgiving somebody that cut out in front of us in traffic, and here God says, look, I'm going to forgive you. I am going to forgive you for anything in your entire life from beginning to end if you will just recognize my authority over your life and start to follow me. Amen? Can you imagine? I mean, like, that is just an amazing gift that you and I just kind of sometimes maybe sit back and go like, yeah, God forgave me of my sin. And then we park it there and think that we don't have to exercise that same thing. But I'm here to tell you today that we have been forgiven much. As individuals, we have been forgiven much. If you take just a minute and you look at your life, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? You don't have to tell me about what's gone on in your life, but God already knows what's gone on in your life, and you need to tell him. And you need to give it to him. You need to go like, God, if I haven't done that already, I need to do it. If you're here today and you have never come to Jesus and just offered your life, invited him to, you know, look at your life, tell you what's going on, confess your sin, give it to him, receive his forgiveness, you need to do that today. Because there is no better offer you will ever be given in your whole life than to receive the forgiveness of Almighty God. Amen? It is the most amazing. You talk about radical. Somebody, turn to your neighbor and say, it's radical. It is like off the charts, friends. That is like you will never be given such an offer in your whole life, any bigger or any better. Repentance is necessary to experience that forgiveness, and you need God. Amen? You and I need God. We open the door to grace while we shut the door to Satan when we forgive. Did you know that? Some people think, well, you know, like, I think I've forgiven. I think I have. I don't want anything bad to happen. But if you rehearse that inside of you over and over and over, it's going on as a recording on your in your head, and you talk about it, you have not forgiven, right? You have not forgiven. You need to give it to him and leave it there. Okay? That doesn't mean that you're saying that anything that people do to you is you know, that's wrong, how they wrong you, that you agree with it. You don't agree with it. You just simply understand the forgiveness, the immense forgiveness of God over your life, so that you turn and you are willing to forgive someone else. It's a big deal, isn't it? And it's hard, just for the record. And the disciples go like, God, we're going to need a whole lot more faith to do that, right? Seven times in one day, God? They're not sincere. They don't mean it. It doesn't matter. How many times have you asked God to apologize, you know, that I'm sorry, God, I repent and go right back to your sin? Uh-oh. You didn't need to answer that, by the way. I just wanted you to reflect on it. We empower God to work in our behalf and to heal us when we forgive, my friends. It's just as God's forgiveness of our, you know, like he comes. He granted you and me forgiveness before we even called for it. But in order to experience it, you need him. Amen? And you have to offer yourself to him in repentance and go like, God, I know you. There's this forgiveness. You died so that no one would perish. You died for the sins of the world, God, but I need to recognize that, call on your name, give it to you, and I get to walk in the experience of forgiveness. See, in our Christian walk, as followers of Christ, we get to experience his forgiveness every single day. And it's why the enemy's so quick to get us uptight and mad at somebody, so that we will hang on to that unforgiveness, which truly does not set us free to be who we need to be walking in his forgiveness. It gets you sidetracked. You understand? We need to experience it. So then we turn around and we more willingly give it to someone else. And in so doing, we're saying, God, that's yours now. I'm going to step back. That hurt me. That took advantage of me. But you are God Almighty who loves me, and I'm going to leave that person with you. I'm not going to worry about that anymore. I'm not going to talk about that anymore. I'm going to give it to you, and I'm going to trust you, because your word says that even when people mistreat me, you're going to make that work for my good, and I believe in you. Do you see how forgiveness works? You have to give God that power, that devotion to the Lord. We empower him to work on our behalf and heal us. We sow seeds of faith to forgive by moving in compassion. God is rich in compassion. He's rich in compassion as he, you know, spreads himself over our lives. Every day that we, you know, every day we fail, don't we? If we're real and we're honest, every day we've had a wrong thought, a bad attitude, a wrong action. We've said something wrong. There's that duct tape, right? You know, you need that, right? And there's all kinds of stuff that we go through as human beings, and God says, I know it. But if you just understand the magnitude of my forgiveness, then you and my compassion, then you will be compassionate with other people who are struggling just like you. And it's a mindset. It's a mindset that Jesus wants us to embrace. We look the most like our Savior and our Master when we have that compassionate, forgiving spirit. We demonstrate the strength and power of Christ moving in us. No sin is too great for God to forgive. We know that. We've seen it time and time again in Scripture. Peter shows us, you know, here he is. He's had this, I can do it kind of a attitude, and he, you know, even goes so far as to try to tell Jesus what he ought to do and how he should save the world. And then, if that wasn't enough, he denies him three times. And then God says, oh, my forgiveness and my compassion is so great, Peter, you just receive it, right? Just exercise your faith to receive it, and you will see what I will be able to do in your life as a result of that. And you and I, nothing that we have ever done is outside of the blood of Jesus, amen? We just have to call on him and ask for his help. 1 John 2:2 says, His atoning sacrifice for our sin is for our sins, and not only for ours, but the sins of the whole world. There's a Christian author and educator and pastor, Eugene Peterson. If you have the Message Bible, you are reading something that he put into words. He wrote it. He was the author of it. He translated it into contemporary language, and I've used it for years and years and years. I like to just, when I want to just read the Bible, there are two translations that I just sit down and I read it like a novel, and it just is just so meaningful. It's smooth, you know, I just go through it, but the Message is one of them. And Eugene Peterson wrote the Message Bible. He's now 81 years old, and one day he was sharing about what it meant to become a devoted follower of Jesus. And he actually was asked this question, which I think is most interesting, and then I'll give you his response. As you enter your final season of life, what would you say to the younger Christians who are itchy for a deeper and more authentic relationship? And Peterson answered, go to the nearest, smallest church and commit yourself to being there for 6 months. If it doesn't work out, find somewhere else. But don't look for programs, don't look for entertainment, and don't look for a good preacher. A Christian congregation is not a glamorous place, not a romantic place. He's saying that the Christian church are the people of God willing to grow, love one another, live in a spirit of forgiveness, to grow up into Christ. That's the body of Christ, and that's what this church needs to be. Amen? That's what every church needs to be. I thought it was just an amazing statement. And you and I need to invest ourselves in being the body of Christ in our community. And we are equipped in this location, and then we go out. And we do that by looking like Jesus. Each time we come together, we grow in that dimension. Amen? And we go out, and we share who He is. We exemplify His love. We put on his compassion. We operate in forgiveness. We extend mercy. There's just, you and I have an opportunity, if we are willing to step out in that radical forgiveness of Almighty God, we will be a people confident in who He is. We will trust Him. We will accept every assignment that He brings, and we will walk it out in the power of His Spirit. And we know that we can't do it apart from Him. You cannot live as a Christ follower without the work of the Holy Spirit. You cannot do it. You will never be able to accomplish it. You can come to church and you can act spiritual, but you cannot live as a follower of Jesus Christ without the work of the Spirit. You can't do it. So don't try. Receive what He has for you. Amen? Open your heart up and just go like, God, You have so radically forgiven me. I'm going to experience that forgiveness every day, and I'm going to walk out Your goodness just wherever I go. And people are going to understand that I look different than the world because of You. And I'm going to share with them that it is You. Amen? It is Christ in us who's the hope of glory, and we are to bring glory to God every single day with every breath, with every word, with our hearts, amen? And you can sit back and you can go like, oh, Pastor Mary, I'm just a human being. You are a partaker. If you know Jesus, you are a partaker of the divine nature of Almighty God, and you need to walk that out in power and in love, amen? It's all about love. It will always be about love. It's amazing. Amen? And it's your opportunity to receive it every day. Every day. So, my friends, I want you to look at forgiveness different. Because you and I are going to have to forgive people. Every day, probably, right? And we need to understand this radical forgiveness that God has extended towards us, and we need to be forgiving of other people. With that being said, there is nothing wrong with setting some good boundaries, healthy things to keep your spiritual life in a good place. Amen? So you do those things that the Spirit of God places on your heart, You seek spiritual guidance if you need some help dealing with life, but you look at one another and you help one another along the journey. Amen? Because it's about being one in faith and in the Spirit. Amen? Blessings for you.